Well, we're going to pick up chapter 1 of 1 John at verse 5, where we left off. Now, last Sunday, we made mention of an important distinction between our relationship with God and our fellowship with God. Our relationship with God is described biblically as that of an adopted child. And that adoption takes place the moment that we have the spiritual birth, the moment we're born again. And there's nothing that we contribute to that relationship. It is 100% the completed, finished work of Jesus Christ there on the cross, where he died for our sins and he rose from the dead on the third day. He's alive today to receive any and all of us who will come to him in faith and ask him to be our personal Savior, personalizing the work he did at the cross for the entire world in our lives. And at that moment, we're born again. The relationship begins. It's established. But you know, just like any child-parent relationship, that child's born, there's no fellowship with that parent yet. The child doesn't even really know the parent. And when you think about it, the gospel message that we proclaim that saves us is very simple. I mean, God made it simple. Christ died for our sins and he rose from the dead. And yet we have, for example, in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we got 89 chapters about Jesus and his life, his teachings. We have the rest of the New Testament, books and books that are filled with important truth that God has given us so that we would know him and we would know how to live our lives in light of the wonderful gospel that saves us. John is writing to Christians here. He's talking about their fellowship. As we look at these verses before us, we don't want to read them in terms of some evangelistic outreach kind of message. He's writing to the believers about their fellowship with God. And so as we begin, we see in verse 5, this is the message which we, John, the apostles, have heard from him, the Lord, and declare to you that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. That's a foundational truth about God. He is holy, perfect, sinless, and pure. And that's the idea. That's the way that light is being used here in contrast with darkness. This is something relatively familiar throughout the Bible. The idea, Jesus describes himself as the light of the world. There's that contrast between light and darkness, day and night, often used in Scripture. And when you think about it, it makes for a wonderful illustration, because what does light do? The brighter the light, the more intense, the more is revealed. I'm just speaking for myself and none of you. I might like look pretty good in some dark shadows and you can't really see. But boy, you like at the doctor's office or the dentist, they got the bright light in there, and you see all the imperfections, don't you? You see all the flaws. That's what light does. And God is light. No darkness whatsoever at all. And so that is a foundational truth. Now, why is that important? Well, it's important in terms of our fellowship with him. And so verse 6, if we say that we have fellowship with him and we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. Now, to walk speaks to a continual progression, doesn't it? And that's how it's used in the Bible. So this is not a momentary fall, a momentary backsliding. It's a step after step after step progression, but in sin, in the darkness, living after the flesh in some area. See, there's no darkness whatsoever in God. And so if we are walking in darkness, but we say we have this wonderful fellowship with God, oh, God and I are so close, we're really lying. And the way the tense of the Greek verb there, we lie, it really speaks to the idea of we're lying to ourselves. We're deceiving ourselves. Oh, my fellowship with God is just fine, but we know that there's something in our life that's not pleasing to the Lord, and we continue to live in it. We continue to participate in it. And we're lying to ourselves. And it's not practicing the truth. But then verse 7. But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. So, there is so much here in this verse. Again, we seek to walk in the light. So we want to live that godly life. We want to live a holy life. You know, one of the criticisms, when you talk about the wonderful grace of God, that His salvation is free and undeserved and unearned, and we can't do a thing to earn it, keep it, maintain it. And people say, well, then everyone's just going to go nuts. They're just going to live for sin. You got to give them a bunch of rules of do's and don'ts, don't you? For salvation, that's not the message. God's grace blows our mind. But to enjoy fellowship with God, by all means, we have responsibilities. There is a right way to live if we are to enjoy fellowship with God. And I don't know anyone who's truly been born again who then would run to this idea of like, this is great, I love this Jesus because I can go ahead and send up a storm every day of my life and it doesn't matter, I'm going to heaven. Who thinks that way? Anyone here want to raise their hand and say, that's what I think Christianity is all about? Of course not. We know that we want to live a life pleasing to God. We want to live godly lives. We want to walk in the light. And it is in the light that we have fellowship with one another. But what's beautiful about the end of verse 7 is it shows our inability to do so perfectly. See, we seek to walk in the light. We seek to live the life that is pleasing that God would have us to do, but there is the recognition that we need the blood of Jesus to cleanse us from our sin. That verb, the way cleanses is written, it's a present, active, continuous verb. It's like how today we would use the expression 24/7. That's what's happening, Christian, in the spiritual reality of what it means to be in Christ, to be born again, to be trusting in Jesus as your Savior. It means that the blood of Christ that was shed 2,000 years ago is washing over your life every second of every day, cleansing you from all sin as you seek to walk in the light. His blood is cleansing your failures. But you see, we're seeking to walk in the light nonetheless, aren't we? And there is an aspect where fellowship with God is attainable, is expected. We can enjoy fellowship with one another. The one another is God and the Christian. As we're seeking to live that life with the recognition that the blood of Christ is cleansing me from all my sin. Now, this was obviously something that was being taught in John's day. He's addressing in this letter certain false teachings. There's going to be three here that we cover before we're done. But it's interesting that the teachings still exist today. You know, the people that have this mentality, well, I got a great fellowship with God, and they're walking in darkness. These are conditional statements. All of these ifs, if we say, they're all conditional. Meaning, hey, you may say it, you may not. You know, people are out there saying it. Hopefully it's not you. But if you do say it, you're lying to yourself. Now let's look at the second one, though, verse 8. If we say that we have no sin. We deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So now you can see the potential extreme on the other end. On the one hand, you have people say, oh, I got this great fellowship with God, and they're living in darkness, and they're just living for sin. But then you've got the other extreme where it's like, hey, I've got no sin. I've completely advanced beyond that. If we say that we have no sin in the present, we are having no sin. Well, what you're really saying then is that somehow the sin nature that you were born with, that we all inherit from Adam, has disappeared, gone away. And the reality is that just doesn't happen while we still have these fallen bodies in this fallen world. We wrestle with the sin nature as long as we are here on this earth. If we say we have no sin, we're deceiving ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But the beautiful promise here, if we confess our sins, now remember, he's talking to Christians here. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You know, the faithfulness of God is something we probably don't have to spend a lot of time justifying. I think that we all know that God is faithful. We read that throughout the Bible. Typically, the idea of God's faithfulness, though, is connected with His keeping of His word, and specifically His promises, His covenant. For example, you go back to the Old Testament, the book of Deuteronomy, I read, therefore know that the Lord your God, He is God, the faithful God, who keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations with those who love Him and keep His commandments. And God has promised that Jesus' blood was shed for our sins to be forgiven. So if we confess our sins, He is faithful to forgive those sins. He is not going to come up and say to us, I'm sorry, that's the 20th time. You've maxed out your limit. Yet, isn't it easy to think that way? Remember, Jesus spoke about 70 times 7, and there's still in our minds, we think, well, that means at number 491, I'm doomed. When obviously he's talking about an unlimited supply of grace and mercy. But we need to confess our sins. Why? To restore the fellowship with God. Again, the context is so important. And now this is an important distinction because I've seen this verse quoted so many times in terms of getting saved. You got to confess every one of your sins if you're going to get saved or if you're going to stay saved and make sure you don't go to hell and all the rest. And it absolutely leads to a nightmare for a person because what if I forget one? Well, it says, if you confess your sins, then he's going to forgive you. Wait a minute. He's talking about the fellowship with God. The relationship with God, the moment of salvation we spoke of earlier. God, have mercy upon me, a sinner. Well, there's no doubt you've got to go to the Lord as a sinner if you expect to be saved. You're not going to go to God and say, God, open up heaven for me because it won't be heaven without me in there. No, God have mercy on me, a sinner. You died for my sins. I know, Lord Jesus, that you love me, you died for me, you rose for me, you're there for me. But in terms of the inventory, in terms of the catalog, the idea that somehow we have to lay out every single sin or else he hasn't forgiven the ones that you haven't confessed to him yet, it's not what it's saying at all. What did we just read a moment ago? Remember, this isn't Steve's opinion on this. This is what the Bible is teaching us. The blood of Jesus Christ is cleansing us 24/7 from sin. But sin does separate our fellowship with God. And God will speak to our heart about our sins. And you see, that's the thing about, you know, when you think about a list, because God will bring to your conviction a sin that may have happened a week ago, a month ago, a year ago, right? That happens as you grow in the Lord. And here is the wonderful balance. We're talking about walking in the light, living for the Lord, living a holy, godly life. And you know, the more you do that, the more you realize your need for the Savior because you're a sinner. And it's not necessarily the sins that when you came to Christ that you knew were wrong. I mean, there's those things that maybe you were doing in your life. You say, oh man, I can't believe I've been such a horrible sinner. And then down the road, it's so many other things like, you know, pride, selfishness, you know, bitterness. All these other things begin to open up to you. It's not, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. It's all these other areas of life. And you realize, man, I need a Savior because I am a sinner. And you're walking in the light. And God is bringing that conviction to you. And you confess your sins as they are brought to you. And He's faithful to forgive your sins. He's promised to do so. He's going to keep His word. But you see, He's also just. He doesn't just say, oh, you're my child, you can get away with anything. Let me just sweep it under the rug. He's just. Because whatever sin it is that you committed, Jesus died for it too. You see, justice has been served at the cross for the sins of the entire world. We sometimes buy into this idea that Jesus died for our sins before we were born again. Now we're on our own. Now I better confess everyone at the moment, or else I'm going to be in that limbo and I'm going to go to hell if I, you know, get hit by the bus before I can confess the sin or whatever and I die. Oh no, I can't. And is that how we're supposed to live? No. Jesus died for every sin we may ever commit. And that's why God is just in forgiving us our sins. And notice the detail here. It's right here in the Word. We confess our sins. He's just. He's faithful to forgive us. And notice, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You leave something out? It hadn't come to your mind? Don't worry. It's under the blood. But when God does bring it to our minds, when God does bring it to that conviction, we don't argue with Him. Well, that wasn't a sin, God. Come on. Maybe in the first century it was a sin. It's not a sin today. Or maybe it's a sin when other people do it, but not the way I did it. And on and on and on. No. Confess your sins. Agree with God. Yes, I was wrong. Forgive me. The fellowship is restored. It's not strained by sin. This isn't anywhere near the relationship which is established and founded on God's grace through Christ's finished work. So important to keep these two ideas distinct. Now, verse 10 is somewhat related to what we just read. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us. So on the one hand, you have those say, I have no sin anymore. And that's just wrong. You're deceiving yourself. But then you have the idea, well, yeah, I still have the sin nature, but it doesn't have any control over me anymore. So I have not sinned. I have not acted upon it. There has been no sinful fruit from my sin nature. If you're saying that, you make God a liar. Now, I want to be clear on something, though, because I hear it preached far too often. I disagree with this view when guys go up there and say, you're going to sin every minute of every day of your life on this earth until God calls you home. I totally disagree with that. Because it's a misunderstanding of what sin is. Sin is a choice, Christians. It's a choice we make. How can we be told to walk in the light if we're sinning every second of every day? That's ridiculous. We choose to sin, just like we choose to obey God as well. Now, sin is a very broad, insidious thing. We can sin just in our thought life, can't we? But what does that mean? First of all, it doesn't mean being tempted. Jesus was tempted in all ways like we are, yet without sin. The temptation is not a sin. But what do you do with the temptation? Do you massage it a little and kind of play around with it or whatever? Now you've fallen. Now you've taken that next step. But this is something that, you know, the Pharisees had to learn, right? Because they thought it was just the outward act, not the thoughts. And Jesus set them straight when he talked about hate and lust. So the temptation is not a sin. And we're going to get tempted maybe every minute of every day of your life. I don't know. But that in itself is not a sin. But what do you do with it? What do you do with those thoughts? We're told to take our thoughts captive to Jesus Christ. Replace those sinful thoughts and ideas with God's word, his promises. Pray for maybe the other person on the end of that temptation or whatever the case may be. Choices that we make. We also can sin in our words. And sometimes people say, you know, they just flew out of me. I mean, I didn't even think those words. They were just out there. And I regretted them as soon as they hit the air. Well, Jesus explains that for us, though. The reason that we just blurt stuff out that we immediately regret. We say, how can that be a choice, Pastor? I didn't choose to say it. It just came out. I regretted it as soon as I said it. Well, the choice just goes back a few steps because Jesus said, out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. What have you been putting in your heart? What have you been choosing to sow into your mind and heart? You continue to choose to sow all sorts of vulgar language and maybe whatever form of entertainment or hanging out with people who cuss all the time or whatever, and then you're shocked that some filthy words come out of your mouth. And you say, I didn't even mean to say it. I just popped out. It's a sign of what's in your heart. You choose to sow a bunch of debate and strife, and you just love to watch people go at it, you know, and get into it. And then you're shocked when strife and debate just pops out of your mouth when your heart's poked a little bit. See, it's still a choice, isn't it? And then, of course, obviously, we choose in our actions as well, what we actually choose to do. Sin is a choice. We trivialize it by making it sound like it's something that we're all doing. Like, are we all sinning while we're just sitting here or whatever? You know, that's ridiculous. We choose to sin. But at the same time, Christ gives us victory day by day, year by year, as we walk in the light over the power of sin to rule over us. We are being saved from the power of sin. We've already been saved from the penalty of sin. Jesus died for our sins. We're not going to hell if you're in Christ. But we're not going to be saved from the presence of sin until we go to glory. Until then, the flesh wars against the spirit, and the spirit wars against the flesh, and the two are contrary to each other, and the battle's on. If we say we haven't sinned, we make him a liar. His word is not in us. But again, we confess our sins, the fellowship is there with God that sin separates. Now, last Sunday we closed with verse 4. A major purpose for John writing this letter, and obviously therefore God's purpose, because the Holy Spirit through John is the ultimate author. These things we write to you, that your joy may be full. And we talked about the idea of fullness of joy and the fact that so many Christians don't know the fullness of joy that the Bible seems to say we should know. And John's saying, get this stuff down that I'm going to write to you so that you might have fullness of joy. So it's no coincidence that these verses follow right on the heels of him saying that, is there? And I think this explains why so many Christians don't have the fullness of joy that God would want us to have in life. You see, the fullness of joy, it has nothing to do with whether you're rich, whether you're healthy, whether you're in a great loving marriage and all your kids are on top of the world. And it has nothing to do with any of that. Because you can be bankrupt, you can be dying, your relationships can be falling apart, and you can still have the joy of the Lord. But where you lose the joy of the Lord is when, as a Christian, you try to walk with one foot in the darkness. Amen? Why do so many Christians lack the joy? Because they are choosing to hold on to some sin they know is wrong. They plan to forsake it one day. Maybe the next New Year's resolution, because I've already blown it. It's only January 4th. I got to wait till another year. But rather than repenting and forsaking, they just continue to keep that foot in there. Whether they know it's wrong or not. See, the joy is not something we amp up for ourselves. The joy comes from God, doesn't it? The joy is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. It's the natural development, just like fruit on a tree, of a life that's abiding in God in the Spirit, which means you're walking in the light. So if you're trying to keep that one foot in the world, that one foot in darkness, and you wonder, where's the joy of the Christian life? You've got too much of Christ in you to ever be joyful in the world anymore. And again, just my own personal experience, if I look back to my life before I was ever born again, there was no convictions and guilts of any absolute moral standard. I might feel bad if I hurt somebody or whatever, but it'll pass, you know. But there was no absolutes in there. There was a lot of joy in living for the world. Living for sin, why not? But if, you know, you were to repeat one of those average weekends as a Christian, it'd be the most miserable weekend of your life. Because you know it's just wrong. It's not how God would have you to live. And I believe that that's why so many of us don't have joy. Because we still got that thing we're holding on to that's in the darkness. Let it go. Let it go. Forsake it like you would a deadly poison. God will give you the victory. He will give you the strength, and He will guide you. He'll tell you what to do, moment by moment, hour by hour, to get victory over whatever it is. But here's the other reason I think a lot of us don't have joy. It's sort of the flip side of the coin. Is this unrealistic expectation, maybe because you've heard some preacher out there, maybe some, you know, Christian you work with or whatever talks this talk, but this unrealistic expectation that you're never going to sin again. Right? Isn't that what we just read? This idea that, hey man, how long have you been a Christian? Well, I've been a Christian 12 years. 12 years? You don't have the victory yet? You know, and as we said, the more we walk with the Lord, the more is revealed of our need for the Savior. It may be different sins than they were when you were a babe in Christ, but what did we just read? Hey, if you think that you have no sin, you're just deceiving yourself. Why establish some standard because some preacher said something or some guy you know it said it when it's not what the Bible says? And so then people are all miserable. I don't understand. I've been a Christian so long and I fell again. What's happened? Because this is our condition. We have a sin nature. We fight it. We battle it. We choose to sin. I'm not excusing sin, but at the same time, we should not at all be shocked or surprised. In fact, we're more liable to fall the more prideful we get that we've arrived. Amen? Oh, I will never do that. Whereas our heart's prayer ought to be, I need you, Lord, every hour. There is nothing that is beyond my sinful depravity. Help me, Lord. And remember, Satan knows our weaknesses. I mean, if you can look down on the heroin addict and you've never touched drugs in your life, I don't understand. That guy's a Christian. What's he having a problem with? I've never been tempted to do that stuff. He never done it. The guy who's the heroin addict knows that that's a weakness, and Satan knows that, and that's where the temptation is. Meanwhile, you're subject to temptations that that guy never experiences, and you just are oblivious to them because you're just focusing on the big stuff. When it's all big stuff, if it separates us from God. And I've said this before, I say it again because it's important to remember another distinction between conviction and condemnation. I use the word conviction several times already today. Conviction comes from God. Conviction is good. Condemnation, that comes from the devil, comes from the world and people in the world, often even comes from within ourselves, our own depravity, self-condemnation. The Bible says there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Condemnation doesn't come from God. He doesn't say, I can't believe you did that again. He's outside of time. He knew you were going to do that at the greatest moment of praise and worship you ever experienced in your life. When your hands held high and you feel like you're right there at the throne, God knows 5 days from now you're going to fall flat on your face. And I know it and I love you and I'm worshiping you even now. That's our Lord. So we don't surprise him. We don't take him off guard. Condemnation is not from God. So you say, well, what's the difference? They both make me feel lousy. Conviction, being from God, drives us to God. Conviction comes from God and says, my child, get alone with me. Get on your knees. Open your Bible. Let's talk some things through. Let's pray. Read the Word. Wash yourself in the Word. Get to church. Get the fellowship of the saints. Get on the phone. Call another Christian that you know and you trust. Whatever it is, but it encourages fellowship. Prayer, the Word, that's what conviction does because it comes from God and it drives us to God. Condemnation, all the exact opposite, right? How can you possibly pray, you hypocrite? How can you possibly go to church and show your face after what you've done, you hypocrite? How can you possibly open the Bible and expect anything? See, where do those lies come from? The father of lies, right? That's how you know the difference. He dismissed the lies, replaced them with the truth. If we sin, run to the Lord. Confess your sins. Restore that fellowship. He is always there. We're the ones who move. He stays the same. You are his child if you're in Christ. And if you're not in Christ, why aren't you? You think your sins are beyond what he could ever forgive? You think that God could never love you? He loves you more than you can possibly understand. He died for you. He rose for you. He's alive to receive you, whoever you are, whatever you've done. He give you a newness of life and give you eternal home in the heavenlies when this life on earth is done. Go to him. Again, Lord Jesus, save me a sinner. I believe that you are God in human flesh who died for me and rose for me and you're alive today to receive me and he'll forgive you. He won't kick out anybody. It's a one-time deal though. But the Christian life, and this I know addresses the majority of our congregation, if not all of us, oh, that's a daily act of going to the Lord. Lord, search my heart. Is there any wicked way in me? Am I doing anything displeasing you? God brings things to your heart. Forsake them. Confess them. You do it one day. You do it the next day. You do it the next day. You confess each time. He'll forgive you each time. Ask him, well, why did I fall again? What did I do? What do I need to change? He'll tell us. He wants us to live that victorious life in the Spirit. He wants us to have fullness of joy and enjoy the fellowship we have. He's our Father, a loving Father for those of you who didn't have one on this earth. We're his child that he chose to take into the family by adoption. And he loves us so much. These verses are absolutely essential to enjoying the fellowship with God that our relationship through the cross has made possible in Jesus.